Correct, then you're muted.
Can anyone hear me?
Feedback. Now.
The meeting without cameras, committee will need to identify who they are before making comments. That way, everybody participating knows who is speaking. So we will proceed with disclosure of pecuniary interest and proceed with the applications, if that's all right with the chair.
Okie dokie. Alrighty, so under section 3 of the agenda, disclosure of pecuniary interest, do any of the committee members have a conflict of interest to declare? Seeing none, we will now move forward. So when I, Carissa, or Secretary Treasurer, sorry, when I ask for comment from the applicants and stuff, is it the same, do they have to declare their name and address or just their name and who they are? Like, okay, perfect. So starting with item 4.1 for consent files, B12, 13, and 14 for 4195 McCray Park Road. Secretary Treasurer, can you please provide a rundown?
Absolutely. Morning, everybody. So we are discussing consent files B12, B13, and B14 for 4195 McCray Park Road. The authorized applicant is Vanessa Simpson with Morgan Planning and Development Inc., and the property owners are John and Carolyn Healy. And three consent applications have been submitted for the creation of three residential lots. Concurrently, zoning bylaw amendment application file Z624 has been submitted to amend the current rural zoning on a section of the lot, which will be in the area of land, including in around the three lots being created, to the zone shoreline residential. It will also include a buffer area for the adjacent significant wetland on the property and significant woodland on the property. And that area is proposed to be rezoned from rural to natural area protection. And the subject property is 84 acres in size. The area subject to the lot creation is roughly 1.53 acres, with approximately 4 acres in total that are subject to the zoning bylaw amendment for the shoreline residential rezoning. The applications are supported by an environmental impact study as well as a planning justification report. I do have a site plan on my screen just showing the lot configurations. The lots are around half an acre, and the frontages are all at least 30 meters or more. So they all comply with the shoreline residential minimum lot frontage. We did circulate the application in accordance with the Planning Act. Building Department had no concerns. Ramirez Infrastructure Department advised there are existing open ditches along McCray Park Road. Some works for ditch cleaning and establishment of ditching will be required. And I just note that the ditching requirements will be included in the consent agreement, which is a recommended condition of provisional approval. County of Simcoe had no concerns, provided the LSRCA and Township support the application. LSRCA had no objections to the proposed consent and zoning bylaw amendment, and they also provided comments related to natural heritage under separate cover, which are attached to the staff report for this application. The LSRCA advises that the technical comments should be satisfactorily addressed prior approval of these applications, which currently the applicant and LSRCA are working through addressing. So they have an environmental impact study and there's a terms of reference and they're just addressing those comments. One of the recommended conditions for the provisional approval of these consents is that the lands are rezoned through a zoning bylaw amendment. And so the technical comments for the natural heritage that LSRC provided would be finalized as part of the amendment. Granted, if the committee provides provisional approval, the consent, final consent won't be granted unless the zoning bylaw amendment is obtained. In accordance with the Planning Act, Ramirez County of Simcoe, LSRCA, have reviewed the applications, supporting documents, and concurrent zoning bylaw amendment against the applicable policies, which include PPS 2024, Lake Simcoe Protection Plan, County of Simcoe Official Plan, and Ramirez Official Plan and Zoning Bylaw. The environmental impact study submitted with the application does confirm the limit of the wetland woodland features and does provide appropriate buffer and mitigation measures to ensure that the development doesn't negatively impact the property. The lots are within an existing shoreline residential designated area within Ramirez's official plan. And the SR zoning of the new lots proposed through the amendment will align the zone category of the new lots with the existing official plan designation. And based on the review of the proposal submitted, subject to the recommend conditions, it is the opinion of staff that the applications have satisfied the required policies for the granting of provisional approval for the consents, which would again be the Provincial Policy Statement 2024, Lake Simcoe Protection Plan, County Simcoe Official Plan, and Ramirez Official Plan and Zoning Bylaw. The recommendations, should the committee find it appropriate to grant provisional approval of the proposed consent applications, the following conditions are recommended to ensure that the development of the lots is achieved as presented. One is satisfying the requirements of Township Ramirez financial and otherwise, including payment of outstanding taxes and cash in lieu of parkland for each lot to be created by consent. Second condition is provisions of a registrable legal description on the parcel to be severed, together with an electronic copy of the applicable reference plan. The third condition is that the severed and retained lands be rezoned from rural to shoreline residential, as well as natural area protection, to the satisfaction of the Township of Ramirez. And the fourth condition is that the owners shall enter into a consent agreement for the lots to be created by consent. This agreement shall be registered on title, binding on all owners, heirs, and assigns to address the development of the lots. The suggested motion, should the committee find it appropriate to approve the subject consent applications, the suggested motion is that the Committee of Adjustment receives report BP6024 dated December 3rd, 2024, and that consents files B12, B13, and B1424 be approved with recommended conditions. The alternatives are that the committee could amend the suggested motion or otherwise defer or deny the applications. Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary Treasurer. So I will now invite the applicant or their representative to speak on behalf of the application. Can you please introduce yourself since there's no camera and let everybody know who you are? Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Vanessa Simpson. I'm assuming everybody can hear me well. I'm the planner on the file with Morgan Planning, representing the applicant today. I do have a short presentation. I mean, the chair has really gone over the bulk of the details. So I can just quickly flip through and just kind of reiterate a couple brief comments. And if you have any questions, I'm more than happy to address those as well. So as the chair has mentioned, the property representing today is 4195 McCrae Park Road. You can go to the next slide. So you can see the subject lands here. It's a fairly large parcel. They have approximately 668 meters of frontage along McCrae Park Road, and the area is approximately 32.6 hectares. You can flip to the fourth slide. Yeah. Flip one more. There we go. So another look at the property. These are some aerial imagery. The property is currently vacant. There is no dwelling, no structures. It's currently forested. A large portion of the property is forested. As you can see in the kind of smaller image on the right, there is an area that has been used for agricultural crop fields. And this is the area of the property where the applications are proposed. Go to the next slide. So as previously noted, the lands are zoned rural and natural area protection. The lands are designated both shoreline residential and natural area protection, and the lands are designated greenlands in the county official plan. So a brief overview of the consent applications. The applications propose to create three new lots. Yeah, just next slide there. Yeah, perfect. It will be for a total of four lots. So it will allow for potentially four residential dwellings to be built. So one on lot A, B, C, and then one on the retained lands. As noted, a condition of the consent application is a zoning bylaw amendment application. And it will rezone this kind of area of the property to shoreline residential. So the next slide, just kind of another view. Next slide. This is an overview of the zoning bylaw amendment application. Number eight. Yeah, there we go. So as noted, that portion of the property where it's field, no trees, will be rezoned from rural to shoreline residential. And it will modify the natural area protection zone as well to align with the environmental impact study that's been completed. So there'll be a large 30-meter vegetation protection zone around that woodland and wetland area to ensure protection. Next slide. This just kind of shows where those zones will be placed. Slide. So a planning report has been completed and prepared in support of the proposed application, both the consent and zoning application. And the report addresses all the applicable planning policies as noted here. As also noted, the environmental impact study had been prepared to address both the woodland and wetlands on the property. It dives right into all the natural heritage features and applicable policies. The EIS outlines appropriate mitigation measures to ensure that the features have no negative impacts and recommends the vegetation protection zone, which we're going to be providing through that modified NAP zone. There should be no negative impacts to the natural heritage features, assuming the mitigation measures are implemented. So in conclusion, the consent application will create three new lots for a total of four lots. The conditional zoning bylaw amendment is required to rezone the lands to shoreline residential zone to support the creation of the residential lots and ensure they meet the zoning provisions. The proposed applications are consistent with applicable provincial, county, and township policies. In addition, we have reviewed the town's staff report and recommendations and conditions associated, and we have no concerns. Thank you for your time. And again, if you have any questions, I'm happy to address those. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Is there anybody on attendance here or on Zoom who wished to make further comment on this application from the public?
I'm currently seeing no one else.
Okay. Then I will open it up to the committee. Member McMillan, would you like to begin?
Thank you, ma'am. Okay, start over again. Thanks, Madam Chair. like I said, I did a site visit. The land is there, it's appropriate. We're given approval, providing they get the zoning amendments. They've done all the studies, it looks like, and I have no problem with the application. Thank you, Madam Chair.
You're welcome. Okay, Member Truex.
Okay, I also was out and had a look, and Dan said the environmental impact study is being done. So if, once it's, I think it says here December 9th, it's supposed to be done. And that I have, once that's done, I have no problem with the application.
And Member Walker.
I also did a site visit and I have no concerns. The signs were up and everything looks good.
Perfect. So I read all the reports and appendix 5 and 6, I believe, go into depth to say that the severed properties will have negligible negative effects on the ecological habitats in the woodlands and wetlands. So I just wanted more information on the consent agreement. If the severed properties are having no negative effect, why is the consent agreement being applied to those?
So the consent agreement, typically we will require those, usually even sometimes for one lot, but typically if it's two or more. And one is for the ditching work. Two is for the environmental impact study mitigation measures. There is going to be a buffer zone between the area of the lots as well as the actual wetland. And then I know the EIS is, everything's being finalized, but just so that those measures are registered on title permanently for the long term. And then also in terms of the lot creation, if there was any other, I think the main thing would be that the ditching as well, and then the EIS.
Okay. My only concern with the mitigation members was like who enforces it. So once it's on title, who actually makes sure that if they're followed?
So in terms of, one second, I think our planner's jumping on. One second.
We can do that one. So any time that somebody goes to apply for a building permit, the consent agreement is kind of triggered into their lot grading review that they have to do. So that's noted to make sure that, you know, vegetation removal is only done on certain times of year, that, you know, areas are seeded and those types of things. So the building inspectors go out and check on that. And then if it's the regulated property, then the conservation authority would also have a hand in it. And that's just sort of the mechanism to make sure that it goes all the way through down to the building permit.
Okay. Yeah, my only issue is the sediment. It says that the sediment needs, like the erosion control needs to be inspected daily. So are the building inspectors going to go out every single day to make sure it's still in place?
So when the construction is being undertaken, that is something that the worker should be doing. The building inspectors would be going out for the prescribed building inspections, like the footings, framings, all the other stuff that they do. But in terms of the sediment being inspected daily, that would be something that would be the onerous would be on the developer to ensure that's happening.
I also had like kind of trouble with the vegetation removal. So from what I understand, they're only going to be able to remove vegetation between the months of September and March. So are we going to then tell people they can only start building their house in September?
So in terms of the vegetation removal, that would need to be followed. And in terms of the actual construction of the house, they would need to either do that before and then start the construction work, or if it was, I think the vegetation removal was up until September, then they could start after. But yeah, they do have to work within the confines of those recommendations.
That's like the big one I struggle with, because it says the vegetation removal is for the birds nesting. But then if you read the EIS study, it says that there's negligible negative effect on the nesting because the meadows open, cleared, small to support the nesting, but then they can't remove the vegetation because of the nesting. I just think it's going to open up a lot of problems if we're telling people they can only start digging their foundations essentially in the fall and winter because of nesting that isn't supported in the severed portions, if that makes sense.
So for the vegetation and tree removal, like that could happen kind of at the beginning of spring prior to that restriction being in place. I believe it was March 31st, but I'd have to pull up the EIS to double check. But they could, you know, get that removal done ahead and then proceed with the construction in the summer, but they can't remove the trees and they can't be removing vegetation during the time specified in the EIS. Okay.
So they could start scraping the property March, February, and then like that's the vegetation. So they could actually dig and do installations after March 31st. It's just the actual removal of the earth, technically.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Just, I know if I was building a house and I was told I couldn't start until September, it would open up a lot of problems for the township. So I just wanted to clear that in my head. So, okay, moving forward then.
To say something.
Sure.
Yeah, sorry, I was trying to find that raise the hand button, but I didn't find it fast enough. I was also going to say for this, through you, Chair, I understand your concerns and they're definitely very valid concerns. For this specific property, there's very little vegetation, like tree removal, that has to happen to allow for construction of a dwelling to begin. So it shouldn't be too concerning for this property. I think that the team can navigate, you know, removing those very few trees before construction would begin so that there's no timing issues with, yeah, starting construction in winter. Nobody wants to do that. Everybody wants to get going in spring. So for this specific property, I don't think that there'll be too many issues just because there's very, very little trees that need to be removed.
Yeah, I agree. That's why I wasn't sure if vegetation meant like literally the grass that they would have to remove. So I was like, that's kind of getting a little restrictive on if we're approving properties to have houses built on them, then I think we don't want to over restrict them to not allow them to be built. So if we're talking trees, yeah, there literally are no trees on in the meadow. So
yeah,
awesome.
I think
go ahead. Did we lose her?
We did lose her. I don't know.
Okay,
Vanessa, I think you're
Oh, I'm here. Sorry, okay. I was gonna say. I think the EIS and I think the vegetation is only really restricted to trees. From my understanding.
Well, so will the consent agreement be a little more, I guess, specific so that there is no open-endedness and up to debates? And I just don't want to approve something to be on title and then have arguments down the road and multiple opinions.
Like, yep. So it shouldn't be subjective at all. The consent agreement would be registered on title. And then in terms of the vegetation removal, it is more specifically talking about like shrubs and trees and things of that nature.
Perfect.
It's not like, you know, and in terms of if you're doing grading and stuff like that, that will all be part of the
lot grade
building permit. Yeah. Okay. The lot grade review process. And was there anything further? Have I addressed your question?
No, I just want to try to alleviate arguments and headaches for the building department, especially down the road, and try to work through that now.
Yes.
If I may, the details of the consent agreement are reviewed by both the applicant and the municipality, as well as the township solicitor. So the exact details of the consent agreement haven't been investigated yet. Like there's an additional sort of fee for that and processing and review to ensure that the appropriate mitigation measures are incorporated into the agreement as a schedule. Also, the natural heritage comments are being finished up with Conservation Authority. So they will be part of that consent agreement and those mitigation measures. So it's not something that we would have exact answers for right this very second, because it's not to that point. But that's why the consent agreement is listed as a condition, and then it's reviewed as part of that process later on, and it's a legal agreement.
Perfect. So we're not copying and pasting Appendix 8 onto it. Okay. Awesome. Perfect. Thank you, everybody. This is my first time kind of dealing with this, so I like to understand and learn from it. Awesome. So we will move forward then. I will put forth the recommended motion as presented on the staff report that the application be approved. Moved by member Walker, second by member Truax, all in favor? And that's carried. Thank you. Okay, moving on to item 4.2, consent file B1524 for 2237 Concession Road 10. Madam Secretary Treasurer, take it away.
Okay, discussing consent file B15 and variance file A2124 for the property 2237 Concession Road 10. Authorized applicant is Vanessa Simpson with Morgan Planning and Development, Inc. And the property owner is Derek Patrick. An application was submitted to request the consent to allow for the creation of one new lot, along with a variance application requesting relief from the deficiency in the minimum lot area of the retained lands. So the minimum lot area for agriculture parcel in section 72A is 40 hectares. The retained lands will be 30.863 hectares, so a variance of 9.137 hectares. We note that there was a withdrawn application. Variance file A2024 was circulated within this notice of hearing. However, it was deemed unnecessary as there is a zoning bylaw amendment that is a required condition of consent for the severed lands to ensure the existing uses on the property can continue. So that will be addressed through the amendment. It just keeps it cleaner. And then I just have a site plan on my screen showing the proposed severed lands outlined in black and highlighted yellow, and then the retained lands as well. The proposed consent will permit the severance of the existing buildings and surrounding lands that are contained within the settlement area of Udney, of which are designated hamlet in Ramirez's official plan. Retained lands will continue to be used for agriculture purposes, are zoned and designated agriculture in Ramirez's official plan, as well as the zoning bylaw. Both the severed and retained lands will be accessed from an entrance off of Concession Road 10, as proposed within the application. Severed lands have an existing entrance from Concession Road 10 with a frontage of 21.7 meters. The severed lands have been designed to protect the future orderly development of the settlement area of Udney by ensuring existing lands within the settlement area are within the severed lot. All land designated agriculture are contained within the retained lands, essentially separating the two official plan designations on the existing parcel. The severed lot will continue the existing uses until such time as the lands, if proposed to be developed as part of the rural settlement area by plan of subdivision or otherwise. The applications were circulated in accordance with the Planning Act. Romero Department cited no concerns. The LSRCA cited no concerns. Recommendation that owner pays the LSRCA plan review fee, although I believe that has already been satisfied. County of Simcoe Planning Department noted no concerns that it's in the hamlet of Udney and in the settlement's designation where lot creation is permitted. County's Transportation Engineering Department cited no access will be approved from the county road to the retained lands. So we note that the applications for both the severed and retained are proposing accesses through entrances off of Concession Road 10, and no further comments have been received to date. In terms of the proposed variance, there's four tests under Section 45.1 of the Planning Act. The first test is the general intent and purpose of the zoning bylaw going to be maintained? And as per the staff report, the application has demonstrated that this test has been met. Agriculture zone is to protect and support agriculture uses. The minimum lot area requirement in the zoning bylaw exists to ensure agriculture land parcels are viable for the intended use. The agriculture use currently existing on the retained lands is proposed to continue, and the existing operation is demonstrated that on the parcel it remains viable.
Is the general intent and purpose of the official plan maintained? The retained lot is in the area designated agriculture or mayor's official plan. And no changes to the boundaries of these designations are proposed. Based on the review of the application supported documents, the application has demonstrated this test has been met. In terms of the variance being desirable for the appropriate development of the lands, the agriculture uses are not expected to be impacted by the reduction in lot area as they are currently being utilized for agriculture purposes. A new entrance will be obtained from Concession Road 10 to access the agriculture lands. And for the last test is the requested variance minor in nature. The actual reduction in area, pardon me, is around four. Sorry, I have something blocking my computer here. The actual reduction in land area is about 4.057 hectares, which is the size of the severed settlement area lands. No negative impact to the property or surrounding land uses as the agriculture lands uses are expected to continue. Any application for development or building permit will be subject to the appropriate policies and requirements. And the application has demonstrated that the variance is minor in nature. In accordance with the Planning Act, Ramirez County and LSRCA staff reviewed the application and supporting documents against applicable policies. And based on the information submitted and per staff report BP5924, it is the opinion of staff these applications have satisfied the required policies to grant provisional approval of the consent application, subject to the recommended conditions, as well as the granting of the requested variance as it satisfies the four tests required under the Planning Act. Should the committee find it appropriate to grant provisional approval of the subject consent file B15-24, the following conditions are recommended. One is satisfying requirements of the Township for Mayor, financial and otherwise, including payment of standing taxes and cash in lieu of parkland for each lot to be created by consent, which there is only one. So, and the payment of cash in lieu of parkland. Two is that the owner and applicant successfully obtain approval of minor variance file 82124 to recognize a deficiency in retained lot area, and provisions of a registrable legal description on the parcel to be conveyed together with an electronic copy of the applicable reference plan for the severed lands. And four is that the owner applicant successfully obtain a zoning bylaw amendment for the severed lands to address the existing uses, lot frontage, maximum lot area to the satisfaction of the Township of Ramirez. Should the committee find it appropriate to approve the minor variance, the following reasons can be provided, and that is general intent and purpose of the zoning bylaw, as well as Ramirez official plan and County of Simcoe official plan will be maintained. Requested variance is desirable for the appropriate development of the subject lands, and the requested variance is minor in nature. Should the committee find it appropriate to approve the consent application and variance application, the suggested motion is that the Committee of Adjustment receive report BP58224, published to December 3rd meeting agenda, and that consent application B15-24 be approved with the recommended conditions, and that variance file A21-24 be approved as presented. The alternatives are that the committee could amend the suggested motion or otherwise defer or deny the applications. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you so much. The applicant or the representative now has time to speak further on the application, if appropriate. Please introduce yourself.
Thank you. Vanessa Simpson, Morgan Planning, here to represent the applicant. Once again, I have a presentation to share with you. So these are the subject lands, 2237 Concession Road. Next slide. You can see, there we go. Okay, so the concession, the subject lands have approximately 310 meters of frontage along Concession Road 10. They also have frontage along County Road 169, approximately 633 meters. The total property area is just shy of 35 hectares. And as already noted, it is important to understand and to note that a portion of the lands are located within the Udny settlement area. You can go to slide number 4, please. Again, looking a little closer at the property through aerial imagery, you can see a water course runs north to south down the middle of the middle and west side of the lands. There is a railway line that runs northwest corner to the south of the lot, which you can see here, it basically divides the lands into two parcels. The property is currently developed with a single detached dwelling, an accessory building, which is a chip truck, and a detached accessory structure, which is a storage barn, and is serviced via a private well and septic system. Next slide. The subject property is zoned entirely agricultural within the township's zoning bylaw. The property has a split designation, both hamlet and agricultural, and the lands are designated partially as settlement, agricultural, and greenlands in the county official plan. Next slide. An overview of the consent. The consent application proposes to create one new lot within the Udny settlement area with frontage along Concession Road 10. The proposed severed lot will contain the existing single detached dwelling, the home occupation in the accessory building, which is a trip truck, and the detached accessory structure or storage barn, along with the private well and septic system. The retained lands will contain the agricultural lands with an entrance off of Concession Road 10. And all the retained lands, the agricultural lands, are outside of the Udny settlement area. Slide. One more down. Yeah. So here we can see a lot configuration sketch. The lands in yellow are within the Udny settlement area, and those are the lands proposed to be severed to create one new lot. So the planning application report has been prepared and submitted in support of the proposed applications for both the consent and minor variance applications. The report addresses the required applicable planning policies. Next slide. Yeah. Okay. In conclusion, the consent application proposes the creation of one new residential lot within the Udny settlement area. The retained lot, or the agricultural lands, are located outside of the settlement area. The concurrent minor variance application will be addressing the minimum lot area for the retained lot. And as noted, a future zoning bylaw amendment application will be submitted to acknowledge the deficiencies with the severed lot, as well as addressing the uses of the land on the severed lot. The minor variance application meets the 4 tests as outlined by Section 3045 of the Planning Act. We have reviewed the staff report and recommended conditions, and we have no concerns. Thank you for your time. And if you have any questions, I'm happy to address them.
Perfect. Thank you, Vanessa. Is there any other persons in attendance here on Zoom who wish to make a comment on this application?
I am seeing none.
Perfect. I will open it up to the committee for comment. Member Truax, if you'd like to start.
Mike.
I was by, and I don't see any problems with the application at all. Good to go.
Awesome. Member Walker?
I also did a site visit and read all the reports. I have no concerns.
And Member McMillan?
Thank you. I did a site visit also. It's there. Staff did a report. It's in the hamlet of Udny. It's allowed. If it wasn't in the hamlet, it probably wouldn't be supported. It's supported. It's following the boundary of the of the hamlet of Hudney. It's good. The concern I had was the comment from the County of Simcoe. Although the owner applicant is not requesting an entrance off the county road, but in their bylaw, it says that it's supposed to be off the township road if it were feasible. They're directly saying it's not permitted. What are the criteria for to be feasible? And have they done a feasibility to come out with a statement it's not permitted?
So I believe their bylaw refers to it where there is the option to connect to a local road, that the property shall obtain the entrance from the local road. Now, the owner could apply for an entrance permit with the county down the road. Maybe their policies would change, but I believe that the bylaw is more if there is opportunity, if the land has any frontage on a municipal road and they can obtain entrance permit to the township, then they don't want additional entrances that aren't necessary. So I know their comment letter, it says it's all prohibited to have an entrance off the county road. But that being said, with the way the lots are configured, both of the lots will have access from the local road concession, Road 10. So I think, although the actual bylaw doesn't sound like it's prohibited, it more sounds like where possible. And then the county did say it's not permitted. At the end of the day, they do have access legally to an open road. And maybe in the future, the county policies would change. But as it stands, it sounds like they're not going to grant an entrance if they were to apply anytime soon. But I do think that because they do have the access, I think in this case, it's okay.
Yes, thank you. It's just that I just like the author of that statement. What criteria do they look at when they say if it's not feasible? Have they done it and stuff? Like at some point in time, like the retained lands or agricultural, they may want a field entrance, which would be in the long run be safer and stuff. It has nothing at this time to do with this application. The owners aren't requesting an entrance or anything. It's just I'd like to know what criteria they want when they're feasible. And other than that, I support the application, the report. Identifies all the things. Thank you, Madam Chair.
You're welcome. I agree. I was in the same boat. The majority of the actual tilled lands are off the county road. The only access from concession 10 looks to be not tilled, and then the creek runs at an angle. So I just assumed that they would try to put a culvert in and maybe a bridge over the creek to be able to access the farmlands. And if the LSRCA doesn't agree with that, or they find they can't do it, then maybe the county would allow at least a farm entrance off county road, if not necessarily a residential entrance, but maybe a farm entrance. So I had the same thoughts. Yeah. Other than that, I think the zoning bylaw amendment's appropriate for council to tackle for the existing uses and the deficiencies. So I'm also in favor with the recommended conditions. So I will put forth the recommended motion as presented on the staff report that the application be approved with the noted conditions. Moved by Member McMillan, second by Member Truax. All in favor? And that's carried. Thank you, everybody.
For both of them,
do I have to vote on the minor variance first?
It's all on one blanket. One motion.
Perfect. Thank you for mentioning that because I forgot that.
Thank you, Council. Okay. Thank you, Committee.
You're welcome. Skipping over item 4.3 because it was just the county comments regarding the file we just discussed. So item 4.4 is a consent file B16 for 6420 Bluebird Street. Madam Secretary Treasurer.
Thank you. Yes, so consent file has been submitted for the mentioned property 6420 Bluebird Street, as well as parts 8, 9, 10, and 11 of plan 51R
41112. The authorized applicant and agent is Christian Hodge with Dale and Lessman LLP, and the property owner is Damian Ewing. And the application submitted requesting consent for the creation of a new lot was previously created through consent in 2018. The certificate of official was not registered on title to finalize the lot creation, so the consent lapsed and a new application is required. Subject lands are within an existing built-up rural neighborhood, abuts Lake St. John, and are adjacent to the Orillia Rama Regional Airport. These lands have been previously granted approval of consent applications, and I have the file numbers listed. There's quite a bunch. And they were approved in 2017 in order to adjust boundaries, establish a new lot, and create easements. The intent of the 2017 application was to separate the two existing residents. So there was two single family dwellings so that each dwelling could be on its own residential parcel, and to keep the residences on parcels that are separate from the airport lands. Although some of the consents were finalized in 2017, not all certificates of official issued by the township were registered on title by the applicant's or owner's lawyer. So not all of the consents that were granted are valid today. Only part of the consents remain valid. Now the parcel identification numbers at present don't match the current parcel fabric of the subject lands. The consent application is required to rectify this issue and to finalize the residential lot creation. And approval of this consent application will result in the proposed lot fabrics for the severed and retained lands to match the existing parcel identification numbers seen in the property index map. So that the property index maps you get from land registry. And I do have the image on my screen just showing the parcel identification numbers map, and the configuration of the ownerships currently do match the proposed, the effect of this application will have, which will match the lot fabric with the ownership fabric. We did circulate the application in accordance with the Planning Act, and the Township of Romero, County of Simcoe staff have reviewed the application and supporting documents against the applicable policies. Romero Building Department commented no concerns. Romero Infrastructure commented no concerns. And if a new entrance is being created or if the entrance is being altered, entrance permit will be required through Infrastructure Department. And County of Simcoe Planning commented no objection to the proposal in principle. No further comments have been received to date regarding the application. There was a group of owners that did ask about it, but no formal comments other than that. In terms of the staff report, BP 5724, proposal will allow for the two existing dwellings to be on separate residential parcels of land, with the residential use being permitted under the land's designation and zoning. And they both have been, the proposed lots have been operating as separate lots, both serviced with private septic systems, both with frontage on Bluebird Street, efficiently using the existing lands, and will keep the existing residents as separate lands from the airport. And they are decent sized lots of severed lands and retained, both around, one's 3 acres, one's almost four. And they were granted variances to exceed the maximum lot size in 2017, as well as variances to address the lot frontage of 27.3 meters, whereas the zoning bylaw required 30. So the variances are remain valid today for these lands. Based on the review of the proposal submitted and per the staff report, staff are of the opinion the application satisfied required policies for the granting of provisional approval of the consent, subject to the recommended conditions being that the applicant satisfies the requirements of the Township of Romero, financial and otherwise, including the payment of outstanding taxes, if applicable, and the provisions of a registrable legal description and draft transfers prepared by a solicitor on the parcels to be severed and merged together with an electronic copy of the applicable reference plan.
Suggested motion is that the Committee of Adjustment receive report BP 5724, published to December 3rd meeting agenda, and consent, and that consent application B1624 be approved with the recommended conditions and alternatives. Our committee could amend suggested motion or defer or deny the applications. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you. Will the applicant or the representative please introduce themselves and advise anything they wish to present for this application?
Hello, I'm the representative for the owner, Damien River Ewing. My name is Christian Hodge from Dale and Lessman. I frankly don't have very much to add. We're really dealing with a technical merger under the Planning Act. There were consents that were granted in late 2017. They were registered as notices on title to both of these properties and were not effectively registered under the Planning Act. So those consents ended up lapsing. So we're basically looking to rectify those consents that were formerly issued. If you have any questions, please let me know. Happy to explain the nitty gritty of what went on here, but we weren't involved in those 2017 or 2018 applications. My client purchased this property in 2023 December. So please let me know if you have any questions.
Okay, thank you. Is there anybody from the public or on Zoom attendance?
I'm seeing no one else.
Perfect. I will open it up to the committee then. I promise I'm not texting. I'm trying to pull this up on my phone since I can't see up there. We'll start with Member McMillan.
Thank you, Madam Chair. As I did a site visit, at first I was a little concerned till I straighten out this here. I'm not sure how far Bluebird Street ends, but I see by the survey now that the committee dealt with, and when the original survey was there, all the frontage is off the turnaround.
Yes.
And not at the where there's a gate across, and that's the private driveway. Yeah. And I have no concerns. Thank you.
Welcome, Member Trex.
Yes, Member. I have no concerns with the application. Unfortunately, I didn't make a site visit. The roads weren't allowing it. So, but I did read the whole thing and looked at everything, and I have no concerns.
Right. And Member Walker.
I did a site visit, and it's probably good that you didn't go because there's a few cars in the ditch, but I have no concerns.
I agree. It's a little hard looking on paper to wrap your head around 12 different parts forming to be two properties now. until you go there, I'm familiar with the property going to Tailwinds and stuff. So the easements, they went through and everything. So we're just now dealing with half got registered and yes. Half didn't. Okay. Yeah. So no issues at all. So I'm in favor as well. So I will put forth the recommended motion as presented on the staff report that this application be approved. Moved by Member Walker, second by Member McMillan, all in favor, and that is carried. Thank you so much. Moving on to item 4.5, minor variance file A19 for 7607 Somerset Park. Secretary Treasurer, please proceed.
Thank you. Okay, so we are discussing the mentioned file A1924. The authorized applicant is Devin English Renaud, and property owners are Mark and Jenna Shivers. And the purpose and effect of the application is a variance application submitted to request relief from the accessory building maximum height provision in order to allow for the construction of approximately 49.05 square meter detached garage, which will require a 1.42 meter variance from section 217 for the maximum height of an accessory building.
And then I just have a site plan thrown up on my screen, showing the lot boundaries and location of the proposed garage, as well as a cross section of the proposed garage, just to demonstrate the height. We did circulate the application in accordance with the Planning Act and Romero Building Department, as well as Infrastructure Department, commented no concerns. We didn't receive any further comments to date, and the application and supporting documents were reviewed for conformance against applicable policies, being the Provincial Policy Statement 2024, County Simcoe Official Plan, and Township's Official Plan, as well as zoning bylaw. In terms of the minor variance for the four tests, is the proposal minor in nature? Yes, the proposal is considered minor as the use is permitted. Accessory building is of a smaller footprint, physically accessory to the principal building, and no negative impacts to the surrounding lands and community are foreseen should the 1.42 meter or 4.6 feet height increase of the proposed garage be granted. The test two is proposal desirable for the appropriate development or use of the land, building, or structure. Due to the smaller size and unique shape of the lot, inclusive of the location of the existing septic system and that the lot abuts the water, the requested increase in height is desirable for the appropriate use of the proposed building to allow for adequate residential storage without compromising the open space or potential encroachment of required setbacks. Compared to if the garage were supposed to be at a one-story, it would be twice the footprint size to accommodate the amount of storage space requested. Test three, does the proposal maintain the general intent and purpose of the zoning bylaw? It complies the zone category permitted uses, and all other provisions of the zoning bylaw are maintained, apart the minor increase in height requested. The garage is further back from the street than the main dwelling and is of a smaller size than the main dwelling. Garage is proposed to be placed at exactly the minimum required front and interior side yard setbacks, leaving an additional 2.4 meters further distance to the required high watermark setback, which is ideal. And the test four is, does the proposal maintain the general intent and purpose of Romero's official plan and county official plan? And the lot's designation does accommodate small-scale residential development, including accessory uses. The garage is ancillary to principal residential use. The garage further does not deter from the character of the surrounding lands, as it is proposed to be further from the street, of a much smaller size, and again, most surrounding lands properties do include accessory buildings. Should the committee find it appropriate to approve this minor variance application, the following conditions are recommended. That the variance pertains only to the request as submitted with the application. And actually the second condition recommended for the land surveyor setback confirmation, that's actually part of the building department process anyway, because if you're within half a meter of a setback, you're going to have that done. Since it's being varied, it is definitely within half a meter of required setback. So we're thinking of just including the one condition because the other one is already going to happen. So it's up to the committee if they want to include it as a second condition or not. But for now, I'm just recommending condition one, that the variance pertains only to the requests as submitted with the application. Should the committee find it appropriate to approve the variance? Again, the following reasons can be provided, and that's that it meets the four tests of the Planning Act. The suggested motion is that the Committee of Adjustment receive report BP6124, published to the December 3rd meeting agenda, and that minor variance file A1924 be approved with the recommended conditions. And the alternatives are that the committee could amend the suggested motion or otherwise defer or deny the applications. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you. Does the applicant or representative wish to speak further on the application? Okay. Is there anybody from the public or on Zoom who wishes to speak?
Can you guys hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay, great. I just wanted to note that the sort of condition that was originally put in the report for the confirmation of the setbacks, It would be appropriate to put that on as a note on the decision, just to ensure that that setback confirmation is done during the building permit process, so that when the permit is being reviewed, that note is sort of carried over into the building permit process. So it wouldn't necessarily be a condition of approval, because it wouldn't be a condition that could be satisfied prior to the building permit being issued. But I think it would be prudent to put it as a note on the decision, just so it gets carried through.
Was that Jen?
Yes, that was Jen. And further to Jen's comment, for variances, we're just going to have that note, I think, going forward, so that it's just caught the applicant. There's no surprise when someone gets to the building permit stage that they do need that land surveyor confirmation.
Well, if I can speak out of character or out of order, can a building permit even be issued if the minor variance hasn't been approved yet?
No, you cannot. Definitely not.
Okay.
But it's more.
So how will they get site verification at the foot-in inspection if the building permit hasn't been approved?
So they wouldn't be able to. So once the permit is issued, they could then start the construction work. So they could then prepare the footings. And then at the footing inspection, they would need to ensure that they submit the setback verification. That way the inspector can pass the footing inspection and then they can pour. Okay. But yeah, it would need to be issued for sure. But the variance, they wouldn't even be able to process the application until the appeal period is passed.
Yeah. Okay. Because that was going to be my only question, is I know when I was an inspector, minor variances had to be actually like approved and done before the building permit could be even issued. So I was like, well, how can we make the building permit a condition if this isn't approved and the permit can't be issued until this is approved? So, okay.
On the decision would ensure that that verification gets triggered by the building department, because we want to ensure that anything that's being required sort of due to a minor variance that would be additional, you know, other than it's similar to like the Lake Simcoe Protection Plan, where, you know, the ground is supposed to, you know, not be uncovered, or things are supposed to be seeded as soon as the weather is available to do that. Instead of having that as a condition, it's just not enforceable. So if we can put these things on as a recommended note on the decision, then it just allows that to get carried through once it leaves planning, and then goes into the building permit process. Because now that we don't have residential site plan approval, it's difficult to capture that information so that it carries through. So putting it as a note makes it so that it's not a condition, but then still puts the wheels in motion to make sure that that actually happens.
Yeah, it makes more sense to add it as a note than a condition, I think.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Perfect. So I kind of spoke at the turn there, but I'm opening up to everyone else. Member Walker, would you like to start?
I tried to do a site visit, but I took one look at that road and thought, I'm not going to get back out of it. So I did read the reports, and I have no concerns.
Sorry, yeah, go, Member Truex.
Go, okay. Yeah, I got down and had a look at that one, and everything looks good. It's not going to be out of place or anything. Everything's kind of going to just kind of blend in, so I have no concerns.
Yeah, Member McMillan.
Yes, I was there before the snowstorm on Friday and got a site visit. I have no concerns. It's ditch in the neighborhood. My only question, clarification through the staff, is condition one, the variance pertains only to the requests as submitted. Well, isn't that standard? Like if somebody puts a minor variance in, it's just for that application. Why do we got to put it in as a condition?
So we like to put that in as a condition, just in case it's ever interpreted as, let's say, for example, it was a setback being varied and they wanted to then add more buildings, but now they just have this established setback of, let's say it was 2 meters and now they have this variance for a 0.7 meter setback, let's say. And in this case, with the height of the accessory garage, it's just to ensure that it's just for the one garage only. We're not varying it
for anything, like anything else. We're not varying a height of a boathouse. We're varying the detached garage.
So the application is strictly for this, what's here.
Yeah.
If they abandon their plans and say, okay, we got this, we're going to build something else to this height, it doesn't apply?
We would need to review it again, right? So if they were to then say, ah, never mind, we don't really need this. We're going to do a boathouse, but we're going to put this giant boathouse that's really tall right at the water. We have this accessory building variance, so we can, it just ensures that the scope and intent of the application and just that it's just a garage for storage. It just ensures that we're capturing that and that there's no future room for interpretation where maybe there's a new owner or what have you. They come in and they say, I do have this variance. I think that staff would definitely investigate it regardless, but it does just kind of help keep the variance clean. So we do like to recommend that condition often, but it's up to the committee if they want to include it or revise it or anything like that, or forgo the condition.
It just seems that we're putting it in specific for this one. I believe there's been other minor variances and where it was just, well, it goes with the property, but thank you.
Yeah, no problem. And I think Jen might be on Zoom. I know sometimes we do recommend that condition, but not always, but often.
For clarity's sake, we always, I think, always have that as a condition on the variance. It would be very rare that we wouldn't have that. A good example of that is if somebody does vary an interior side yard setback, let's say for a 20 square meter shed, right? And then they come back later and they've doubled the size of that garage. It's to make sure that anybody who would have been circulated that may not have, you know, cared about a 50 square meter garage, but may turn around and care about a 100 square meter garage. It's making sure that it's actually coming as presented. So it's as the committee is reviewing it, as staff are interpreting it, as what is being presented, to make sure that it's not bigger or more than what was asked for, sort of like a misconception.
Perfect. Makes sense to me. Yeah, if I had to wrap my head around that, accessory buildings and structures are defined as multiple things in the zoning bylaw. So as you mentioned, they could come back and have a 6.42 boathouse, and it technically meets the definition of the minor variance as an accessory structure. So I can understand that. Okay, I have no issues. I actually did a site visit this morning and the road was lovely and plowed. And it seems that there's a bit of a rental storage cubit that you're probably using as storage right now. And those have poor ventilation and aren't lovely to deal with. So I can understand wanting an actual functional detached garage to use as storage. So I have no issues with this application. So do I have to amend it by removing condition two? And
I think if the committee is good with the first condition, I think we can remove that second one for sure. But not sure if the committee is keeping that first one. If so, then you can just go with the suggested motion of just the one condition approved as presented.
Okay. I understand the intent of the first condition. I'm okay with removing the second and adding it as a note. What's everyone else's thoughts?
Yep. Okay.
Perfect. Okay. So I will put forth the recommended motion sort of as presented, removing condition two, keeping condition one, but that the application be approved. Moved by Member Walker, second by Member McMillan. All in favor? Carried. Thank you so much. Moving forward to item 4.6, minor variance A22 for 7751 Oak Ridge Drive. Madam Secretary, please proceed.
Thank you. We are discussing minor variance file A2224. Authorized applicant is Brianna Ellen with Sustainably Drafted, and property owners are James Wegler and Keely DeMano. And a minor variance application has been submitted for the subject property 7751 Oak Ridge Drive to request relief from the minimum setback of the high watermark setback in order to renovate and expand the existing dwelling. This variance will require a 2.3 meter variance to the required 15 meter high watermark setback under section 228 of the Township Zoning Bylaw. I do have a site plan on my screen showing kind of the existing footprint, the new development, and the portions to be removed, just for those that are online. And in terms of circulation, the application was circulated in accordance with the Planning Act and reviewed against applicable policies. And the Remer Building Department commented no concerns, noting that a building permit will need to be obtained for the proposed addition. And we actually have not received any further comments to date on the application. In terms of the property, I do have a site plan, or not a site plan, sorry, a map photo, just showing the 100-year flood line, as well as the elevations provided by the surveyor. So we see that there's the existing wood deck and shed, which show to be in the flood line. And the application does propose to remove those as well as expand the dwelling further. And where that expansion is happening, part of it is within the flood line. So in terms of the provincial policy statement, the development and site alterations, it says development and site alteration shall not be permitted within a floodway, regardless of whether the area of inundation contains high points of land not subject to flooding. So in terms of the four tests, according to the staff report, basically the proposal must demonstrate that the area being developed is not within the floodplain for the development of new habitable living space to be supported under the provincial policy statement 2024. So in terms of the four tests, that's the biggest thing is we are not able to confirm whether or not the four tests have been satisfied under the Planning Act, as the Planning Act requires applications demonstrate conformance with provincial policy. And given that provincial policy does not allow for development within the new development within flood prone lands, staff are recommending that the application be deferred as presented, based on the reasons that we can't confirm if the four tests are satisfied yet. And so we recommend that the committee defers the application to allow time for a flood hazard assessment to be undertaken in order to identify or refine the mapped floodplain on the lot, or potentially otherwise that the design is amended to move the living space outside of the floodline. The suggested motion is that Committee of Adjustment receive report BP6224 published to today's agenda, and that minor variance application A2224 be deferred for up to 6 months to allow the applicant time to obtain a flood hazard assessment in order to identify or refine the mapped floodplain on the lot, or otherwise to allow the applicant time to redesign the proposal in order to move the proposed new living space outside of the floodline. Now, the alternatives are that the committee could amend the suggested motion or otherwise otherwise approve or deny the applications. Thank you.
Thank you. Would the applicant like to speak further? Just state your name if you could please and your address.
I'm Brianna Allen of Sustainably Drafted. Address is Unit
52-1107 Muskoka Beach Road in Gravenhurst. After receiving communication with Carissa, I am okay with deferring the minor variance until we can do the proper studies and possibly move away from the water a little bit. The property is a little bit tight. It does look like there's space, but it is bedrock towards the road, so it is not as easy as just shifting back and still fitting a septic in. So we are struggling a little bit with the septic design. It is actually a big issue with why we've had to move over. So we do just need to re-look at the site. It's a full and redesign or do the proper study.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you. Is there anybody on Zoom?
I am seeing nobody for Zoom comments.
Okay, perfect. Opening up to the committee. Member Truax.
Okay, if the applicant is they're willing to have it reassessed, the flood line and everything, I just agree with the to defer it for 6 months until they get the study done.
Okay, Member Walker.
I also agree with the deferral.
And Member McMahon.
I concur.
Okay. Yeah, I agree. I think we've all seen how high the Black River can be. And if we're making something new, it would be nice to stay outside of that. If I'm looking at the site plan correctly, it does seem like there's only a tiny jut out that's affected. So it may be worth trying to redesign that a little bit. So then the study doesn't have to be done if I'm interpreting all the reports correctly. So I think having 6 months to kind of figure out what is best and appropriate is good. Okie dokie. So I will put forth the recommended motion as presented on the staff report that the application be deferred up to 6 months. Moved by Member Truax, second by Member Walker, all in favor. And that is carried. Thank you so much. Last one, item 4.7, certificate of cancellation for 18 Ferreira Road. Secretary Treasurer.
Thank you. Just going to share my screen, although. So the certificate of cancellation for 18 Ferreira Road. So 18 Ferreira Road was previously created by consent through consent file B2817. Since the creation of this property, the current landowner has proposed a boundary adjustment. Committee of Adjustment has granted provisional approval of consent number B-224 to allow for a boundary adjustment to sever about 899 square meters from 7 Balsam Road to be merged with 18 Ferreira Road. In order for this boundary adjustment to remain valid on title of the lands, a cancellation of consent file B-28-2017 is required. Section 5345 of the Planning Act does allow for an owner of land that was previously conveyed with a consent to request the issuance of a cancellation certificate of such consent. Approval of the requested certificate of cancellation is appropriate to allow for the proposed boundary adjustment, which has already been demonstrated to comply with provincial and local policy through report BP2224 and as permitted by the committee's decision to grant provisional approval of the boundary adjustment consent file B2-24. And the recommendation is that the committee of adjustment receives report BP6324, published at today's meeting agenda, and that request for a certificate of cancellation for the lands legally described as part of lots 10, 11, and 12, Register Plan 15146, MARA Part 2, Plan 151R41756. And then we have, I'm just going to keep the motion up here, S/T SC1617648. Romero in the County of Simcoe be approved.
Perfect. Thank you. The applicant or the representative like to speak further?
I am seeing no comments.
Anybody from the public?
None that I am seeing.
Perfect. Moving forward. Member McMillan, start us off.
Just housekeeping. item, I guess. Just a question, not to deal with this, but when we put the condition in satisfying the requirements of the township financial, including payment of taxes, and that's just to deal with the subject property that's before the application.
Yeah, exactly.
If it's not.
Exactly. Yeah. So if you're going to be, if we're issuing the final consent certificate, then just for the existing property where it hasn't been severed at all, just that there is all the taxes to date are paid up to date. So we just check that the day that we would issue to make sure. And that way, just to hope that there's no issues when there is. Well, in this case, I don't know that there would be because it's just a boundary adjustment. If it was a lot being created, then it just kind of ensures that hopefully there's not really any issues when the sale happens. We just kind of want to help the potential future owner as well as the current one to make sure. And if we're issuing the consent certificate, we do want to make sure property taxes are paid. So, yeah.
But it's just a subject property that's under the application.
Exactly.
Thank you.
Betcha.
Okay. Member Trex.
Okay, I have no problems with what they want to do.
Perfect. And Member Walker.
Yeah, I have no concerns.
Perfect. Yeah, I looked at this and I'm like, this does not look familiar. And then I'm like, oh yes, I had a baby this year and I miss this one. So I had to do a little backtracking to become familiar with this. But yeah, no, I don't have any arguments either. So I will put forth the recommended motion that it be approved. Moved by Member Walker, second by Member McMillan, all in favor. And that motion is carried. Thank you so much, everybody. Moving on to item 5, adoption of minutes. I'm assuming everyone had a chance to read the draft minutes for the November 5th Committee of Adjustment meeting. I think we have to. Does anybody have any errors or omissions requiring a revision? Seeing.
I wasn't here for the meeting, but on the scheduled meetings, I don't have it in front of me. You scheduled the meeting for January in the year 2026. It's on the same date as January 2025, the Tuesday. There's a difference in day there.
Okay.
It's probably just technical error, typing error.
No, but I will double check that. So is that on the minutes themselves?
It's on the schedule meetings.
Okay, I'll look at the schedules and make sure I fix the January date issue.
It's a minor thing.
Perfect. No, I appreciate it.
Perfect. So then essentially you do not vote then. So I'll have a motion that the draft minutes from the November 5th meeting be approved as presented. Moved by Member Truax, second by Member Walker, all in favor. Carried. And last, unfinished or new business. Any unfinished or new business to present? Nope. You okay? Yeah, go for it.
Just one question. Probably 2 months ago, Municipal Affairs sent out something on the email to register for sessions for the new provincial policy statement 2024, but we haven't heard nothing back any update.
So, and I'm not sure if you received an email or not. I received an email from the, I'm not sure what the exact, who sent it, but it was from the province. And when I tried to go on to access the videos, the downloads would not work at all. And I tried a few times, and I believe I have a draft email sitting in my drafts to clarify, because I wanted to do that training too, but couldn't access it. So why don't I follow up with the province email that I have, and then I can get back to you once I hear back, because perfect. I would also enjoy accessing that. I think we would all benefit from it.
So following up with that, we have training at the for next meeting.
This meeting.
Oh, what a surprise. Okay. And then I wanted to bring up under the second item,
You had a nice little explanation for why each condition was being suggested, and then it wasn't on any other ones.
Oh, in the actual agenda?
Yeah, like with the three conditions, it kind of explains staff's reasoning for wanting to include those conditions. Mm-hmm. I rather like that. How much extra work is that for you guys?
So I'm not too sure, like in terms of the actual, we're talking just the agenda and not the reports, right? Like not the full agenda package, but just the
report, like kind of what we read, like when you're like, especially because like we just asked a couple times why these conditions are being presented.
Oh, you mean how I think our planner Jen had outlined really well, like an explanation of the conditions.
Concession 10. Yeah.
So moving forward, would that be helpful for just to have an explanation of the conditions for every report?
So then we can kind of wrap our heads around it and maybe not take up time asking. Well, it's nice to ask questions, but then at least we can get like more of an understanding prior to the meeting.
Yes.
If it's not like an abundance of work.
No, that I think that
eventually it will become like a copy paste kind of thing for you guys. But yeah.
Well, we're changing kind of the way we're writing them a little bit just to make sure that they're with, you know, current practices. And I think that what Jenna's done this month with her reports, we can definitely reflect going forward to just give a nice explanation of conditions and then committees and understanding and then public, that'll also help them a lot.
Exactly. Okay, yeah. Cool. Awesome.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So if there's nothing else, I will move to an adjournment. So recommendation that the Committee of Adjustment meeting adjourn at 11:15 a.m. Moved by Member Truax, second by Member Walker, all in favor. And we're adjourned. Woo!